Okay, welcome my behalf also to this webinar. So this part will be in English. Hopefully you can understand it. There will be quite much text in the slides also, so you can maybe read it later on. So my name is Teemu Heikkinen. I'm from the University of Applied Sciences, like Jan already told. And I'm dealing with the energy efficiency issues in this project, or kind of involved with those issues. And this presentation is about energy efficiency in small ports, some basics of energy efficiency and some examples. Here's the contents, a bit more detail. So basics, then something about energy consumption in small ports, then some basics of solar energy utilization, and then some examples of earlier investments, like you saw also in the Janos presentation earlier, the pictures and some explanations what there has been done. Okay, but first then about what is energy efficiency. As you probably all know, at least some of you know what it is. It is basically saving energy. So you make changes so that less energy is consumed for the same task as earlier, and some energy is saved. So if, for example, change light bulbs to LED lights, you get the same light or even better, but with less energy. That's energy saving and energy efficiency. So in other words, the produced and paid energy is used in efficient way. And there are these kind of terms like specific consumption, which is used when kind of comparing different, for example, okay, I'll put that off. Yeah, sorry. The specific consumption is a term that is used, for example, comparing different type of houses, for example, and their consumption. So can it be like area based, how much energy or heat or water is consumed per area, floor, or volume, cubic meter, or so. So you can compare different consumption of different kind of buildings, for example. So it's a good kind of way to compare. With energy efficiency, emissions also decrease, and natural resources are saved. This is one important thing why EU is, for example, running this energy efficiency directives and etc. to really to get the effects for fighting climate change. So decrease emissions, and also natural resources are saved when we need to, for example, burn less wood or whatever is used for energy. The keys to improve the energy efficiency are, like, first you have to, of course, measure the current use of energy. How much energy is consumed and for what? Where does it go? You need numbers. Then you need to plan for both technical and functional improvements. So technical, like, for example, changing the light to different technology, or adding automation or such. And then the functional improvements can be just thinking of basically how you can change your behavior, or kind of how can you advise your clients or port visitors at what they could do maybe better to save some energy. So that's functional improvements. Then after you have planned these, then implement these, make the changes to processes or gadgets, install new technology, then verify the change, to compare basically for the first phase, measure again how much energy is consumed now. So this is kind of basic process. The number four is maybe something that is often left out. You can many times trust that it will be better. The energy efficiency is better anyway, but it's good to good to get some readings also. So basically, simply the energy efficiency, or let's say what is needed, is to start thinking about energy consumption. Really kind of change the mindset that where does the energy is consumed, is consumed in my place or in this port, for example. What is the biggest consumption part and what is maybe smaller, where to start, etc. Kind of change the your mindset so that you are considering the energy. The motivation, two big thing: fighting climate change, kind of cutting emissions, especially CO2 emissions, and of course saving money. When you use less energy, you pay less for the used energy and save some money. Here on the right side, I have some examples, some basic examples of how much is, for example, one kilowatt hour of energy. How can you come up with using 1 kilowatt hour? For example, you have a 10 watt light on for 100 hours, or you heating up water, or using sauna, electric sauna. So you can kind of see that there's a big differences depending what kind of gadget you have on. So there's a big differences in the way they consume energy. Then there's an explanation of this specific consumption. I already explained a bit. You can see it in more detail here. And then I added here a couple of links. Another one is to EU pages telling about energy saving companies. Another one is this Estonian page, which I found. I don't know if you are familiar with the concept, this energy saving companies, but the idea here is that there's like companies related to energy efficiency or energy installations anyway, and they are not just installing and selling you energy efficiency equipment, but the idea is there that also the funding is either all or partly comes from the savings you get from the changes you have made. So the idea is there that you don't have to necessarily pay anything for the investment, but you're kind of paid with the savings you get from the energy savings. So that's the idea behind the ESCO companies. And I'm not sure how much there are these in Estonia. I didn't find the information, but this is like growing numbers, and this is like by EU some kind of a way to push forward a bit these energy efficiency issues. Then I added one slide of the energy consumption in Estonia. Might be familiar for you, but I basically dig it out for me to find out a bit what's the situation in Estonia. So from there's a couple of slides. Basically, this first picture or graph tells that it's about commercial sector energy use in Estonia. And just main thing is here that see that here that the electricity consumption has been increasing all the time from let's say last 20 years or so, and it's I understood this partly because of the economy has been changing in Estonia to more like service based, from production based to service based, and it's kind of changes also the electricity consumption to, or increases that one. And then these two graphs here are about the houses, residential houses, and space heating. Just to point out that Estonia kind of is not ranked too high in the energy efficiency of the when it comes to space heating houses. And it's then another picture explains a bit that it's mostly because the apartments or houses are rather old. Already the majority of the houses, and of course when they are old, they also, let's say by default, they are less energy efficient. The insulation is not that good, and the equipment may be quite old but are used in the house for heating and for energy. And then to this thing that really the majority of energy produced in Estonia comes from the oil shale production, which is quite bad for what comes to CO2 emissions and climate. So there's in the kind of, when you look it another way around, there's a kind of good potential for cutting down CO2 emissions when you cut down the energy consumption. But this is also changing in Estonia with the growing share of renewables, and there is a national plan to cut down 50% of the emissions in the future. Then something about the consumption in the small ports. This is my list, how I see kind of where about in the ports the energy is consumed. This list is not in specific order, but there's a list of things. So kind of specific thing for ports is, of course, this when you offer electricity for the visiting boats. If they are connected to the grid, they consume electricity, might be quite much, depending on which kind of devices they are using there. Then, of course, when you have houses there or buildings, and if you have mechanical ventilation, that consumes energy, and around the year, if it's in place. Space heating, of course, especially in the winter time. Cooling and air conditioning, summertime, if you have installed cooling equipment like air pumps, air source heat pumps, of course they consume energy. The lighting, indoors, outdoors, and piers. Then refrigeration equipment, so freezers and refrigerators, when they are on, of course they consume energy. Sauna, if you have either electricity or wood heated energy, anyway, energy is consumed. Then washing water, heating of water is something that's kind of big consumption. Heating water takes lots of energy. So if you use lots of warm water, you lose also lots of energy. Then if you have a kitchen cooking equipment available for the visitors, of course those equipment there, how they are used and what is the equipment, how they are in energy efficiency, laundry machines and tumble dryers, and then mobile equipment charging, etc. Then kind of same list, or let's say how you can save energy in these same items. As example, you can educate maybe the boaters a bit that they if they have some water boilers there on the board or something, that if they wouldn't use maybe that much, or they could use maybe your shower or something instead, something. And then you can have your own PV plants or photovoltaic power plant to compensate, as example. So installing new energy production yourself. Then mechanical ventilation, automation, heat-based ventilation. So if you have installed mechanical ventilation, it's automation is very good, and have sensors that they ventilate the moisture and CO2 when it's needed. That they are kind of not on too much or nothing. Space heating related, you can lower your room temperature, also automation there. Utilizing passive solar energy, getting better insulation. So passive solar energy means that it's just let the light in and let the sun heat up the house when it's good, when it's needed. Then this, if cooling is needed, sun shading or eaves are good. They are kind of making it for nothing, not using energy. And also, of course, own PV plant also here. When you have these are nice mats in that sense that when you have a need for cooling, also then you have the best sun available usually at the same time, so you can produce the energy for heat pumps with PV panels. And also to avoid excess cooling, so not cool too much. It just uses too much energy. Usually people are like tolerant for more warm temperatures during summer than in winter time. lighting, of course, LED lighting, automation, different kind of sensors to activate the lights, motion or presence detectors, light sensitive switches, etc. And you can also just use part of the lighting. Then energy efficient fridges and freezers, and a good places for them, so it's well ventilated, so it doesn't have to, the compressors doesn't work too much. If you have sauna, should be well insulated and properly sized stove. When talking about warming washroom waters, just avoid overheating. Adjust water flow nozzles. These kind of water saving nozzles can be installed, etc. And in kitchen, energy efficient, and in this laundry and tumble dryers, just have energy efficient equipment, etc. And something about the EV systems basics, what are the parts for PV systems. This is on-grid PV system, so grid connected PV system. You have the panels there, it produces the DC current, so like normal batteries, kind of same idea. Then you have the, let's say, most important part of the system, the solar inverter, which does many things. Most important thing is that it converts the current to AC current, so it can be used in the home appliances. But also the quality of the electricity must be so good that it can be transferred to network when there's excess energy. Then at least in Finland, there's this need for safety switch, which is for the network operators, so they can switch off the production if they are making some maintenance work in the network, so they don't get electrocuted. Then another side of the dash line, there's this existing system, so your house distribution board, where you connect the system, and there it is distributed to the house appliances. So when the energy is consumed in the house by different appliances, it's used there. And in case there's excess energy, or you need to buy more energy, which is more of common thing from the network, there's this meter through which it goes to network. So from the grid, you can get the excess or the needed extra power, or you can sell the excess energy to the network. It needs to be like meter that measures in two direction, buying and selling. Something about the potential. In Estonia, the potential is quite good. It's close to Central Europe one. And usually normally the best way to install panels are that they are directed to south and about 40 to 42 degree inclination. That's the kind of the best production you can get in a year, during the whole year. Then there are one phase and three phase PV systems. So the inverter is such that it's connected to one electric phase, or all three phases, both are used. The three phase systems are like bigger ones and more common nowadays, let's say. And then good to remember that production and consumption are never in balance, basically. And always you either need to buy the rest from the grid, or then sell the excess to the grid. And normally you need an own agreement with the network, or your, let's say, an energy seller. You need to have a contract with them when you want to sell the excess energy to them. And good to remember that without batteries, it's always auxiliary energy source. And if you install batteries, inverter has to support batteries also. But that can then be done. And there's a link, good link for if you have a, like, frequently asked questions there's a good solar company you can check their web pages for questions and answers. And here's also one kind of table where you can see a bit of how the direction of the panels where they are pointing, and this one here, and then the inclination here, how it affects on the production. This is from Pori, calculated for Pori, so it's a bit different than in Estonia, for example, but anyway, quite close. Just to know that, so that basically southeast, between southeast and southwest, directions are good. And if you have some, let's say 18 to 50 degree inclination, those are the best ones. Then shortly also about off-grid system. They're kind of there you need to have the battery. Well, let's say there's of course panels, then they have a charge controller, and they have batteries. One or more batteries. And from there, then the electricity divided. This is now DC electricity. So this different, it's a different equipment, different kind of lighting and different sockets. But then if you wanna have AC, then you need to have additional device, inverter. This is different inverter than the one in the on-grid solutions. But anyway, you need to have a inverter that can transfer the electricity to AC devices. So the basics. Then a couple of pictures from one port that had installed this pretty small off-grid system. There's a panel on the wall. It's actually later transferred onto the roof because it's shading there. Anyway, then there's a battery. There's an inverter. There's this charge controller and then a fuse box in them, kind of components. In this case, the energy was used in AC. It was transferred to kind of this walking path lighting. Energy was used for that. And something to remember from off-grid, that proper sizing is important when it's kind of standalone system. You don't have the grid where you can take extra energy from, so you need to plan it to like self-sufficient. And the sizing should be based on the present and future needs and the energy consumption estimates of different devices, etc. So you need to know more detail of which kind of devices you will be using, which you can use some restrictions also. Another things what you can do with solar energy, they are also solar collectors. For space heating, these kind of systems, there's like also the collectors which look like PV panels, but there is water is circulating, or let's say water glycol mixture is circulating here, and you get the heat to heat tank, water tank, and you can use it for heating the house or heating the hot water. Then there are air collectors also available, which heat up the air and fan it inside, and they are good for kind of keeping the air in good quality inside room or house, and especially for houses which doesn't have any mechanical ventilation can be also used. And then remember the passive utilization. So let the sun in when there's need for heating and lighting, and then put some protection when there's excess heat, so you don't spend energy too much for the heating or cooling. And some examples from earlier projects. In Kylöpihlaja Lighthouse Island in Rauma, there was two PV systems installed. First one was this, there's this lighthouse building over that. There's 12.5 kilowatt power kilowatt peak system, which produces about a bit more than 10,000 kilowatt hours per year. I added here just a kind of what it would produce in Estonia. Was it Dirhami, or where did I put it? I think that was Dirhami. So to change, you can see that's a bit more it would produce in. Oh, was it? Yeah, maybe. Anyway, so you can see that it's a better here than in Rauma, for example, or there in Estonia. Then some readings. There's a smaller system on top of the service building, 5.2 kilowatt peaks, and they also the estimated production. And here you can see the estimations. These are usually, I'm using this PV piece you can find from the, it's a European Union made tool for like, I don't know, 15 years ago. It's a good tool. You can use it for estimating how your system would produce if there are certain amount of panels and certain direction and inclination. You can see the monthly differences, and these are quite accurate actually. Of course, years are different, but good estimates anyway. Then what was done in Portmet in investments in Sweden? In Gävle, there was some lighting on the handrails of the piers. And then in Sturimfrun in Söderhamn, some off-grid PV panels and lighting there, pier lighting, and also the, like earlier I said, the walkway lights. And then in Tjörkar, Åland, in addition of PV system on a new service house, there's also LED lighting in the house, and then there's a heat pump for heating and cooling installed. And then also there's a map where you can see the places I just mentioned, Söderhamn, Gävle, Tjörkar, Rauma, the map, just Tallinn.